Hi, I'm Niklas Vaara. I'm a doctoral researcher at the Center for Machine Vision and Signal Analysis, and I'm researching the utilization of computer vision-based models for ray tracing-based radio channel characterization. And today, my presentation is about ray tracing for 6G communications and sensing. And first, I'll give you a short introduction in general to ray tracing and how it's utilized in different fields. I think the most famous application is in light propagation simulations. We have different applications such as movies, and here on the right-hand side you can see this image of a very famous corner box. This scene was generated using ray tracing, and you can see that we can get these very realistic simulations. And then we of course can use this for sound propagation simulations, and the most relevant of course in the context of this talk is the radio propagation simulations. And here we have the definition of a ray on the left hand side. It's defined by its origin, and then we have some direction vector D here. And essentially what ray tracing solves is this length along this direction vector to some intersection point. And now if we think about, for example, simulating isotropic radiation, we need to think about the uniform spacing between these rays. So there is always a trade-off between the accuracy and the execution time. And especially in the last decade, there has been this rise of GPU accelerated computing. And this is especially beneficial for ray tracing because we can compute all of these rays in parallel. And especially with the recent modern GPUs, we have these specially tailored ray tracing cores that we can use to even get more significant speedups. And of course, with just ray, we can define the line of sight connections. On the left hand side here, we have reflection and scattering. By reflection, we often refer to specular reflections, which is a mirror-like reflection. And if the surface is rough with respect to the wavelength, we get scattering. And here we have a simple Lambertian scattering model. And here the kind of scattered ray vector length defines the intensity of the scattering. So you can see here that we have the strongest scattering in the direction of the surface normal. And then on the right hand side we have diffraction, which is modeled in the form of this cone, which is known as the Keller's cone, and the cone apex angle is basically dependent on the angle of incidence of the incoming wave. And then we have penetrating rays, which just means that we have a wave that goes through some material. And from these we can of course see that scattering and diffraction are both computationally very expensive to model. Now I've added here some examples in millimeter and sub-terahertz frequencies. Now I have some references here from the literature where the penetration losses and reflection losses and diffraction losses have been measured, and in those papers, the findings were that reflection loss actually decreases at higher frequencies for some materials, and the penetration losses increase at higher frequencies. And diffraction especially is very weak, so we have very significant losses, and we have these very small regions where it actually is relevant. And of course it should also be noted about reflection, that because we are operating at higher frequencies, we get more prominent scattering, so the specular reflections are weaker. And you can read more about the actual measurements and the impacts of these different losses in these papers. So here we have some ray tracing use cases. Here on the left-hand side, we have data transmission simulations. So we can use these ray traced paths to compute a channel impulse response. And we can use this to perform more detailed simulations about the actual data transmission and get things like the bit error rate and block error rate. Another interesting application is machine learning, as these future wireless communication systems will utilize machine learning in the decision-making process. And instead of time-consuming channel measurements, we can essentially generate this data by ray tracing and use that for training. Then here we have more use cases. We have vehicle-to-vehicle and vehicle-to-everything simulations, and especially in these cases, it's essential to have simulation tools because these are safety critical systems. And as an example here, we have autonomous vehicles, and these rely on the vehicle-to-vehicle and vehicle-to-everything communications and their sensor data to drive safely. And we can also simulate sensors using ray tracing, and we can simulate, for example, radars and cameras. And of course, radars have an interesting application for the joint communication and sensing applications. Here on the right-hand side, we have then reconfigurable intelligent surfaces. And these surfaces are capable of directing waves to a desired direction. And of course, it is essential to simulate how this wrist behaves in a given environment to determine if it's worth to deploy it there or not. And here I've left some references of our work. So we have a paper where this ray tracing was applied to wrists, and another paper here that describes more about how the simulator works. We can also use ray tracing to generate coverage maps. So here on the left-hand side, we have this picture of this environment. And here in the middle picture, we have the transmitter point. And you can also see this kind of discretization of these receiver points. And on the right-hand side, we have this heat map that describes the signal strength. And we can see here, for example, that the line of sight connections are very strong, and this has many applications. Example, when studying how the reconfigurable intelligence surfaces behave, so we could generate these coverage maps and see how it impacts the gain. And in the future, we will utilize these digital twins. Essentially, it's an accurate virtual copy of a physical environment. And this will be constructed from multimodal sensor data. We may utilize sensors such as LiDAR or RGBD sensors or radio signals. And it has many interesting use cases, especially for ray tracing, because we can utilize these RGB images, if we have such sensor, to detect the materials. And this is, of course, important for ray tracing because we need the dielectric properties in the environment to perform realistic simulations. And in the future, it is envisioned that these digital twins will be updated in real time, and it will be integrated with ray tracing and machine learning applications that then enable real-time decision making. And here on the right-hand side, we have an example, which is a 3D reconstruction of a corridor here at the University of Oulu that was actually generated using this Microsoft Azure Kinect depth camera. And here's a reference to this paper. You can check that out if you want to read more about that. Now we have these point clouds that we get from the sensors because the implicit data format is a point cloud. And sensors, of course, introduce noise. And another issue that we have is that these point clouds may contain holes. And if we consider traditional ray tracing methods, we have usually triangle mesh-based models. So these models, of course, because they use triangles, they have a concise surface representation, so the intersection determination is straightforward. And in addition, because we have a triangle, we can easily determine the normal vector, which is this vector that is perpendicular to the triangle face that is needed by the ray tracing to, for example, determine the reflection direction. And here in the bottom left, we have this figure where we have these estimated normal vectors using a simple plane fitting algorithm. And as you can see here near the edges, we see this kind of rounding effect because we have to utilize the neighboring point information when we determine the normal vectors. There are many problems, of course, related to estimating these normal vectors. And here on the right-hand side is a kind of preview of our current work. We used the digital twin of this corridor that we presented in the previous slide, and we are capable of finding specular reflections in this environment. Another interesting application for ray tracing is differentiable ray tracing. So if we think about a traditional ray tracing, we have some known input parameters, and then we perform ray tracing, and we get our desired output. Now, differentiable ray tracing can be used to find the optimal input parameters. As an example, on the right here, we have determining dielectric properties of the materials, and I will explain how this could be applied to this use case. So, we do not know the dielectric properties. We can then have some initial guess for these values as the input parameters. We then perform the ray tracing, and the output could be something like the channel impulse response. Now here we have the objective function, which evaluates our simulated channel impulse response, and it could be against something like a measured channel impulse response. So then we get the gradients of this objective function with respect to the input variables, and we can then update the input variables with methods such as gradient descent to learn the most optimal input parameters for this use case. And another interesting application is, for example, learning the antenna orientation and location. And there is actually a open source implementation of such differentiable ray tracing. So it's an extension to this NVIDIA Shona, and you can find more about it in this, I left this reference in this bottom right corner if you want to read about it. I will now conclude this presentation. So ray tracing, of course, has this endless research question: is how can we improve the accuracy and execution time? And we also saw that in higher frequencies, in millimeter wave and sub-terahertz band, we see an increased attenuation. So this motivates the need to research and develop these simulation tools. We also have these joint communication and sensing application and other applications such as the reconfigurable intelligent surfaces that need the physical environment and the actual interactions when performing the simulation. So we need these deterministic simulation tools because we cannot simulate them using a stochastic channel model or anything like that. And these digital twins also will be an important part because they will enable ray tracing simulations to be very realistic when compared to actual channel measurements. Now, there are, of course, problems such as determining the dielectric properties of the materials. And if we, for example, consider penetration, it's very hard to, for example, know what exactly is inside a wall. Certainly, there are some challenges. And differentiable ray tracing provides interesting opportunities for solving different optimization problems. And I'm looking forward to actually seeing how this will be utilized in the future. Okay, that concludes my talk. Thank you for listening.